audience we've ever had, so amazing. Contrary to appearances, there are some spots here in the front on the floor if other people want to come and sit on the floor. Here's what we're going to do. I'm going to ask Liz a bunch of questions for like 40, 50 minutes, and then it's going to be your turn. Then we'll have a break for like 15, 20 minutes with cookies. I would say go get a cookie fast because I don't know that we have enough cookies for all of you. And then we'll come back, and then you guys get to ask both of us questions. Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. And just a quick announcement that we have a couple other really exciting Night Owls events coming. So April 10th and 11th, we have the filmmaker Dan Salit coming here to talk to us about two movies that he made. We're going to watch the movies in doc and then talk to him about them and why he made them the way he did. They're great movies. The Unspeakable Act and 14. Philosopher C.T. Nguyen is coming to, he wrote a book on games, Games Agency as Art, and we're gonna talk to him about whether life is a game and sort of the gamification of life by way of social media. So that's like later in May. So come to those events as well. But now, let's get started. So first, I'm just gonna ask Liz to introduce herself.
Hi, my name's Liz Bruenig. I am a staff writer at The Atlantic.
And I'm Agnes Callard, and I teach in the philosophy department here. So Liz gave a talk yesterday. It was a great talk. And in the talk, she gave this example of a fight that her kids got into. So her younger daughter wanted to try on, like, a dress. And it was some kind of costume, right?
Yeah, it was a costume gown.
Costume gown. And then as she was trying it on, the older daughter snatched it away from her and tried it on herself. And then the younger daughter pulled the older daughter's hair. And this is the point at which Liz intervened in the scene. And Liz said that she chastised her younger daughter for pulling her older daughter's hair, but she mainly chastised the older daughter for snatching the gown. And she chastised the younger one much less than she would have if she had just pulled the older daughter's hair unprovoked. So I was reflecting on this and thinking, as a parent, what would I have done? And I was like, maybe I would have chastised my kid the same, whether he had done pulling his sibling's hair, provoked or unprovoked. And I asked my kids what they thought should happen to them if they did this. And my kids both said, you should give the same punishment, whether it was provoked or unprovoked. And then I asked my husband and my ex-husband, the other two parents in my household, and they were both like, no, obviously Liz is right. You should give more of a punishment if the hair pulling was unprovoked. So the question I want to ask you is, do you have any theories to explain this kind of populational divide? Like, why do my kids think you should give the same punishment whether the hair pulling was provoked or unprovoked, but like the adults, except me, think, no, you should give more of a punishment if it's unprovoked?
So I sort of did the same thing because we had talked about this at dinner last night. So I talked to my husband. And we had discussed last night, my husband is a much more regimented sort of, logical thinker than I am, just sort of operating emotionally off the cuff. And he said he would have punished them the same.
Interesting, okay.
So I was thinking about how to explain this myself. And I'm thinking about states and points in time. And I'm like, look, there was a point in time where we had peace in this house. I was in the other room. Claire was putting on a little dress. Jane was presumably preoccupied with whatever else she was doing. And then Jane turned and looked at Claire with that dress, and evil entered the world, right? And that is the point at which Jane decided, because of this desire she felt, to grab the dress, take it away from her, and then all hell broke loose. And so I think my reaction, my emotional reaction was, Jane, we had a state of peace. What are we doing here? We live in a society. We're trying to maintain peace in the household, but you let your desire overtake you. And I think that's what I initially was like, come on, man. We gotta hold it together for the sake of the peace of the household, and you're getting overtaken by your passions here. As to where Claire, she was overtaken by a passion because she was avenging herself. She had her gown taken away, and so she went over there and was like, yank. And I'm like, yes, yes, you were overtaken by your passion, but because you were thrown into a world of chaos and disorder. Like, you were unwillingly put into a position where it was just passion against passion.
Good.
So I think that's how I came down on it.
For those people who are standing right there, there are some spots where you could be sitting up here. You'll have to kind of make your way through some people that are, but they'll let you pass. It'll be more pleasant than standing. And you may also be able to sit along the sides. Yeah.
But for the children, I think, they're more likely to be on either side. And so they're more likely to say, look, the punishment should be even. They consider themselves pretty likely to be overtaken by their passions at any time.
Right.
And so they're like, I think things should be pretty equanimous across the board as opposed to me being punished specifically for being overtaken by my passion.
Good. So this idea of peace and of like recovering peace gets to something else I wanted to ask you about, which is sort of, do we see forgiveness primarily as forward-looking or backward-looking? Like just this week, I found a little note that my younger son had stuck under the door when my older son was angry at him. And it said, I wrote it down, I'm sorry for calling you a jerk. Do you want to call it quits and make peace? So in that note, right, like you have the apology. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry for calling you a jerk. But there's really this like forward-looking, let's have peace, mm-hmm. right? And my kids use that phrase a lot, like let's make peace, let's have
yes.
peace. Where fundamentally the point of apology is to return to a state where we're happy with each other.
Yes.
Whereas you might think of apology as backward-looking, as like fixing a problem. Mm-hmm. Do you have a view about whether forgiveness is more forward-looking towards peace or backward-looking towards some kind of resolution or reparation?
So I think forgiveness is often cast as a backward-looking and even therapeutic thing. And I think this is a very insidious way to look at forgiveness as a therapeutic thing that can fix something in your past. Because if there's anything I have learned from reporting on the death penalty as long and as deeply as I have, it's that there are some things that can never be undone. And they're done in perpetuity, and it hurts every day. And you can forgive the person, and it's still going to hurt, right? And so I try not to pitch forgiveness in a therapeutic way, because there are therapeutic ways, and there are methods of dealing with pain in your life that can make you feel better about things that have happened in the past. I'm just not sure forgiveness is one of them. Mm-hmm. It may be part of a sort of complex of methods of dealing with pain in your past. But I think of forgiveness as primarily a forward-pitched thing. You know, when I was trying to come up with my own definition, I said, you know, forgiveness is a process that unites the wronged and wrongdoer in a plan of peace. And it can be as thin as, all right, we part ways here, as, you know, goodwill between strangers. You know, I regard you just as well as I would anyone I see on the street, no less, no more. We go our separate ways. And forgiveness can be as little as that, or it can be as much as we're going to develop a relationship now and you're going to be part of my life. Mm. Or it can be as much as I'm forgiving someone very close to me and now we're going to return to, you know, you can't really return to a prior state because this is always going to be part of your history now, but we can achieve a new state of peace. We can accomplish a new state of peace. We have a new plan of peace. So I think forgiveness, when it's pitched backward looking, can actually be quite insidious because people don't always experience forgiveness as therapeutic. I mean, it's as simple as that. So I try not to pitch it that way because I can't guarantee that outcome.
Great. So the thing I found so powerful in the talk you gave yesterday was the connection you made between forgiveness and like egalitarianism, which came out in the thing you just said, where it's like we move forward together. And so like one thing I just want to grant you that you really persuaded me about is that the position of moral exception that anger creates, and especially well-justified anger that is where the justification is well-supported by the community, that position of moral exception, which is to say, where you're now allowed to do bad stuff, but it's okay because someone wronged you first, right? And like the hair pulling is an example, right? Mm-hmm. That is, there's a bit of a moral exception given for the hair pulling mm-hmm. because you know, someone else did a bad thing first. Mm-hmm. So that condition of moral exception where, let's say I've wronged you and now you have a kind of license mm-hmm. to harm me, but it's okay, it's a good kind of harming now because I harmed you first, that is like a really deep form of inequality between people. Mm-hmm. And like if you're an egalitarian, you should be really, really worried about this form of inequality because it's moral inequality. It's like inequality of moral standing, right? Mm-hmm. I just think that's a super profound thought that wrongdoing creates that kind of inequality and that somehow needs to be rectified. But now the question is, does forgiveness rectify it? So like it's occurring to me that, you know, at least for many people, being forgiven feels a bit like a kind of submission or a kind of lowering, which is why sometimes forgiveness can even disrupt a friendship.
Yeah.
It doesn't seem intrinsically like an equalizing move, like God can forgive and we're not equal to God, right? So it also feels a little bit to me like forgiveness may create, if not a debt, at least a memory of the forgiveness, mm-hmm. Where like it's not like it's been wiped clean in the sense that we don't even remember that you forgave me. Right? I could be grateful to you decades afterwards for the fact that you forgave me, so that forgiveness is still sort of there between us. It's still on the ledger. So yeah, I just wonder whether, I wanted to ask you more about this question of like, does forgiveness actually create equality?
Yeah, so I think forgiveness is the closest thing we have to accomplishing that restoration of equality. And, you know, you bring up God, which is sort of my model, my form for thinking about forgiveness. And when you're being forgiven by God, you're being restored to equality with yourself, which is strange to think about, but you have this version of yourself that you were created to be. And when you sin against God, when you do things that are evil or bad, at least in my religion, this is what we think, you diminish yourself, you sustain moral injury at your own hands, and you become less than you were created to be. You fall away, right? You are diminished from what you were intended to be. And so when God forgives you, you are restored to what you were intended to be morally. And so you are restored in a sense to equality with all of humankind, but essentially equality with yourself, which is a strange thing to imagine. But you have this self that is kind of held in escrow, that is, you know, belongs to God and cannot be tampered with, et cetera. And so I think that is the model that I'm thinking of when I think of forgiveness between people, right? And so what I'm doing when I'm forgiving someone or when someone's forgiving me, there is a version of myself in this prior state and time where I hadn't offended that they can return me to, or they can put me in a new state. What you're saying is sometimes this new state, it isn't quite as comfortable as the prior state,
mm-hmm.
right? There's something that feels, you feel the fact that forgiveness is a gift.
Yeah.
Right, and that you can't earn it because all you know, you've injured someone. Now you can go a long ways towards helping someone justify their decision to forgive you. But I think you're going to feel in any case that forgiveness is a freely given gift. I was talking to a death row inmate who was forgiven by the granddaughter of the old woman who he murdered with a claw hammer. And the granddaughter, forgave him. And he told me, I love her more than anyone else on earth. More than his family, more than his friends, etc. And he's like, I love her. I love her more than anyone. I am, and it's because forgiveness, that reception of forgiveness, leaves such a profound impression. And so is that a relationship of equality? I mean, I think so. I think it's a relationship of moral equality, but I don't necessarily know if that's going to feel always like you're dealing with a peer, even
right.
if it is a moral restoration, because you've received a gift.
So what if, let's say I wrong you, mm-hmm. and you forswear moral exceptionism in relation to me without forgiving me. Mm-hmm. Is that possible? Do you think that's possible? Or, like, is your thought, no, forgiveness is just what it is to forswear moral exceptionalism?
So I would say that's mercy. If you say, I'm not retaliating, but I'm pissed, that's
right.
mercy.
Right, and so mercy would then restore equality would also be.
It's another way, and these are related concepts, but they're not synonymous because forgiveness has to do with this internal affective transformation that kind of goes two ways. It goes with the person who was wronged and the wrongdoer. But mercy is about having the capacity to go and rampage all over someone and deciding that you're not going to do that. So we were talking about kids last night. You know, I rarely have to forgive my kids because when they misbehave, they don't really injure me. Like, I'm not wronged by them when they misbehave. It's usually the case that I could punish them, but I'm deciding not to. Instead, I'll just talk to them about it. And so on and so forth. So I think that would be mercy, and it's a related concept, and it's something that I think ancient cultures had maybe in lieu of forgiveness.
Yeah.
And I'm a big fan of mercy as well. It's diet forgiveness. If you can't do forgiveness, you can at least give me mercy. I'll take it.
It's interesting because in the Iliad, there are all these scenes of supplication, right, where it's like, don't kill me, but they mostly... none of them work. They just kill the person anyway.
Yeah, and right up until
Priam and Achilles, it's like a setup.
And I don't know that mercy restores equality. It might help the moral exception problem, right? In that it saves a person from harm, but effectively you have not transformed the person in the eyes of the person having mercy. So like in Seneca, mercy absolutely doesn't achieve moral equality. It's sort of... the very fact of mercy is something that belongs to a master, right? Precisely because their dignity is so high as to be above offense. So I would say mercy, it accomplishes a little of what I want, which is to save people from sort of the ravages of moral exceptionism. But it doesn't accomplish all of what I want, which is to actually restore people to full moral equality.
Good. So what this is bringing out is something I didn't get from your talk, which is that forgiveness proper, as distinct from mercy, is really about helping the wrongdoer relate to themselves. At least it is as much about helping the wrongdoer relate to themselves as it is about having the wrongdoer relate to you and having peace.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Forgiveness is this very weird thing because you have to care about the person who wronged you. And I mean, it's not surprising that Jesus in the Gospels goes around counseling it all the time, and that it's in the Lord's Prayer, etc. You know, forgive us as we forgive, because it doesn't come naturally. You're not naturally very concerned about the person who has wronged you. You're like, F that guy. But it is something that appears to be necessary to achieve the kind of equality, moral equality that at least that I want, that my husband and I think about a lot. Matt thinks about it in terms of material equality. That's how he would achieve moral equality, is to make sure that everyone is materially equal. And I'm on board with that. I like that. But I have a moral plan as well.
But like material equality, he would say, is necessary in order for a person to be equal with themselves?
I don't think Matt thinks about that. I think he's like, that's all, you know, hoodoo nonsense.
Okay, so earlier today, I emailed you, and then you didn't email me back for a while. And then when you did email me back, you said, I'm sorry about the delay. And I did not respond, I forgive you, Liz.
Thank you.
I didn't say that. I said something like, no problem. To me, it's really interesting that there's such a thing as a polite apology, but I think there isn't such a thing as a polite forgiveness.
Yes.
That is, we pretty often will say, I'm sorry, in a very loose way, like, oh, I have a cold today. You might be like, I'm sorry. But we don't use I forgive you loosely or colloquially. What explains that?
Well, because I think because forgiveness refers to an inequality, because it is resolving an inequality, when you forgive someone, you're doing this act of restoration. And if they personally don't feel that they were unequal to you by something that they had done, it actually pisses you off. So if someone comes to you, and this is one of my interests with forgiveness, if someone comes to you and you're under the impression you haven't done anything wrong, like say you left their party early and they're like, hey, I've been thinking about it. You left my party at 6, I forgive you. And you're like, excuse me? It actually really kind of pisses you off because you're like, listen, I didn't do anything wrong. And now you're putting this on me as though I have made myself lesser, as though I've diminished myself through some kind of moral injury, and I object to this. You can reject someone's forgiveness. I have had people reject my forgiveness and tell me, like, I don't want your forgiveness. And I'll be like, okay, well, you still have it, which is even more infuriating. But I don't know what to do with those circumstances, which is why they're so morally interesting.
Yeah, so, like, it was occurring to me that when I'm thinking about, so some people are kind of enemies of forgiveness a bit. Like, you're a friend of forgiveness, you're a proponent of forgiveness. Part of what you were doing in your talk is saying, like, we should be more forgiving. And a lot of people are very resistant to, defensive about, irritated by that kind of statement. And you gave potentially one interpretation of why someone might be resistant to that, which is that when you've been wronged, you're kind of in this advantageous position of moral exceptionalism where you get to do bad stuff, but it's called good. People don't want to let go of that. And so if you tell them you should be forgiving, you're asking them to give up this thing that they want to keep. But it's occurred to me, like, what, like, say we want to, you know, kind of come up with a really good argument on the other side for the anti-forgiveness view, and we want to say, okay, what else can they have besides that, which I agree with you is, like, not great motivation for wanting to oppose forgiveness. And it was occurring to me that I think that there's something kind of sacred about forgiveness.
Yeah.
There's the thought that it really has to, like, come from your heart and from who you are, and that's, I think, is maybe part of why we don't have, like, polite forgiveness and we don't casually forgive, and that the pressure to forgive is experienced as, like, a profane, it's like saying pretend to forgive.
Yeah.
And that people are trying to hold on to that sacredness by saying no one's allowed to tell me to forgive.
I offered several reasons. It's not only the,
okay,
the sort of cynical
so,
ones. I offered several reasons that people have problems with forgiveness. And oftentimes when I'm doing my forgiveness fringe shtick and people are resistant, I point out I'm not a fan of forgiveness because I'm a forgiveness giver. I'm a forgiveness needer, right? And that actually tends to change the tenor of the conversation.
Mm.
Because I'm like, look, I'm not saying you need my forgiveness. I need yours, actually, which is the way that I look at it. So I'm a habitual forgiveness needer, and that's why I'm as interested in forgiveness as I am. But I think, yes, you're right in that being told to forgive is like being told to fall in love, right? You're like, well, I can't just generate these feelings, which is why in sort of my telling, what I try to counsel is to become a forgiving person, which is separate than just, you know, telling people in every instance, you have to forgive, instantly forgive wrongs. I think I'm still thinking about and I'm unclear on whether forgiveness should be conditional, unconditional, whether it should be instantaneous or delayed, et cetera, et cetera. I think these are all sort of case-by-case basis questions. But I think the thing that I would like to cultivate in myself and that I'm talking about when I give my talk is that I would like to become a forgiving person, someone who has that capacity in their heart, who can do that thing. And I think it just has to be cultivated. And it's sort of an ego-destroying thing because you have to get used to, like, looking at it from the other person's point of view and thinking about the fact that they're a person as well and all this stuff that's not really fun when you're pissed off.
And I'm sure you would also say the following, but I'm interested to hear you reflect on why you're not normally inclined to pick this framing, be an apologetic person. Mm-hmm. Like, teach your kids not to be forgiving, but to be apologetic. That is, why gravitate towards the praise of forgiveness over the praise of apology, or is that just that would you just say both equally and you happen to have been speaking on behalf of forgiveness more?
Well, I run into forgiveness a lot more in my work, right, because I work on the death row. And forgiveness can have a real material impact there, where if a family forgives a person on death row, it can actually impact the outcome of their case, as it did in Texas, as I spoke about last night. So I run into it a lot more. It's a lot bigger part of the religion, of my religion, than apology is, forgiveness. It's not, lead us to apologize as we apologize to others, right? And so that's another reason it's sort of at top of mind. Also, forgiveness is harder than apologizing.
Mm-hmm.
It's much easier to put up and admit fault and be like, oh, I'm sorry, and you can give whatever accounting you want, but it's harder to receive that accounting. In fact, receiving apologies is often a deeply uncomfortable and disarming experience, especially when they're very genuine.
So that's so interesting to me, because in an apology, you admit that you did something wrong, and you admit it to the very person whom you wronged, and you might have thought that's the, you know, very top of speech difficulty, but your thought is, no, forgiveness is above that. It's even harder than apology. Why is it harder?
I mean, that's an interesting question. I don't know, we might poll the crowd, because I'm as a Catholic, I'm used to going in and saying sorry. I do it once a month, you know? When, all right, bless me, Father, for I have sinned, and then you list everything you've done wrong, and for these and all my other sins, I am heartily sorry. But that kind of practice of confession bleeds over into your daily life. And so I try to catch myself, my husband and I are also, our practice in our marriage is sort of instant apology. So if we have a conflict, they usually only last about 5 minutes, and then we'll instantly put it to bed. We'll be like, listen, I'm sorry, I was just really heated up. It's nothing to do with you, I'm stressed at work or whatever. Mm. So that kind of instant reflection, instant confession, instant apology, instant forgiveness is something that we've cultivated. We've been together since we were teenagers. So we've had a long time to do that, and it has been a cultivation, precisely because when someone pisses you off, that's it's kind of delicious. Right, and you want to hang on to it. This is why we go on the internet, to get pissed off and hang on to it. But it's a cultivation, and I think forgiveness is even harder because it has so many of those components. As to where apology, you can say as much as I'm only human. You know, we've seen lots of apologies in literature and TV, etc. But how do you forgive? How often do you see someone forgives someone else? How many models of it are there? And the feeling of having someone else like reach into your guts and take your anger out is unsurpassedly weird and disarming. And that's what's happening when someone is asking your forgiveness and you are genuinely forgiving them. Some people experience it as a weight being lifted off of them. But I understand when people instead experience being asked forgiveness as this very strange experience of having their rightful anger, their righteous anger, taken away from them. And so I try to be as sympathetic as I can with that experience, because it's a real one.
Just note that you have water there if you want to drink water. It's not very cold, but it's from a water fountain, so. I wanted to follow up on the instant apology. That's super interesting to me. My husband and I do not have this practice. He's here, so he can confirm. We don't instantly apologize. Sometimes it takes a while. And now you made me think about that. I'm like, hey, why don't we do that thing? Maybe that would be good. Maybe we should do it. And my immediate thought is like, well, often inside of like a fight, it's not clear what's going on. It's not clear what's at the bottom of what is our like dispute. And I often feel like it's an important thing that I want to figure out. And I have to hold on to the fight in order to like explore the territory of like, what is the deep like foundation of our disagreement. And I will admit that my husband would generally be the one who would just make peace and just move on. And I'm the one who's like, no, we have to stay in this and we've got to work it out until we've like understood, you know, the like what is the deep part of our disagreement, and then we figure out which one of us is right. So that's important.
It is.
So I'm wondering what you think about that.
It is important. And I think when I think about the things we fight about, we don't actually disagree fundamentally about that many things. And the things we fundamentally disagree about, like Matt's not Catholic, he doesn't believe there's a God. He's just that kind of stuff just doesn't fly with him at all. But we don't fight about that. Mm-hmm. It's just something that is, you know, I've known him for a long time. I've always known that about him. He respects my faith. I respect the fact that he doesn't, that's not a wavelength that he's on that frequency. So that's okay with me. When we fight, I feel like I'm kind of someone who pops off a bit.
Right.
Just a touch. And and so, you know, why aren't there any eggs in the fridge? I don't know. Why don't you bite me? You know, like I haven't gotten to do the shopping this week. Excuse me. I have 2 trips coming up and something to file. But something like that, you know, just needs to be resolved instantaneously because I didn't mean it, and it's undoubtedly the result of some other stress. And so the thing that's immediately going through my mind is, you know, I trust the question was not meant to. It's really a matter of blind trust, I think, which is I trust the question was not meant to irritate me or indict me in any way. Mm-hmm. I trust he's not searching for fault in me. I trust that he has the right things in mind, and I need to do what I can to achieve peace here.
Is the proportion of apology and forgiveness roughly equal between the two of you? Like, that is, are you apologizing about as often as he's, are you forgiving about as often as he is, or does one of you forgive more than the other one?
Yeah, it's about equal, but it's because Matt is a scrupulous apologizer. So oftentimes he will apologize for things that he said and intended to be kind of snarky that I didn't even receive that way. He'll be like, I'm sorry I said that earlier. That was mean. And I'll be like, it was true. And so that's how those apologies go. And so in that case, I'm not even sure I'm rendering forgiveness because I'm like, oh, I just took it on deck as being fair.
Right. Yeah. So there's a really interesting philosophy paper by a philosopher named Monique Wunderlich about the phenomenon of unforgiveness, whether you can unforgive something. So, like, you know, what if you forgive someone for something, but later you, you know, feel motivated to take revenge, hold a grudge.
It's back on.
I want to read the example she gives of it. She's defending this, that this is possible. Jane and Mabel. Jane and Mabel are sisters. Upon his death, their father bequeathed to Mabel a treasured family heirloom, an antique locket, and Jane destroyed it in a fit of jealousy. Mabel, who loved the locket, initially resented Jane for her infraction, but in response to Jane's apology and expressions of remorse, finally told her sister, "I forgive you." Months later, Mabel overhears Jane gleefully telling a friend that she no longer regrets smashing the locket and plans to destroy more of Mabel's undeserved possessions. Upon hearing this, Mabel's resentment over Jane's destruction of the locket returns. She tells Jane, "I know I said that I forgave you for smashing my locket, but I take it back. You need to set things right."
It's back on. Yeah, I think I would call that a new incident. I would say this is, you're angry about something that happened in the past that you putatively forgave her for, but you're actually angry about a sort of new thing that has been revealed to you, which is a new sentiment, right? And Jane herself is expressing this as a new sentiment. She's saying, I did regret it genuinely, but now I don't anymore. And so I think in a lot of cases with forgiveness, people waver back and forth. And this is something that I talked about very briefly in my talk last night. But even with guys on death row, sometimes they're forgiven, but then the family member who has extended forgiveness, they get to thinking about the crime again. And they have a hard time. I mean, they waver. And I think that's maybe in something that is considered a process, and forgiveness is considered a process. You know, Charles Griswold, in his book, he's very straightforward about this is a process. It's a two-person social dynamic process. I think it's normal to have periods where you go back and forth and you waver. And I think that doesn't really interfere with my vision of forgiveness at all. I think there's great latitude for people to do that and still be on the right moral path.
Mm. Well, so, I mean, I think if it's a new wrong, then it seems to me like it's not wavering.
Yeah, I mean, it would be where I would, if they came to me and were like, all right, judge this for us. Am I being, am I wrong to unforgive? Mm-hmm. I'd be like, you have something new to forgive. mm-hmm. right? Which is your sister is now turned on you, has sort of spat upon your initial forgiveness, and has sort of bitten the hand that feeds, and so on and so forth. And the question is, how are you going to manage? You know, for one, she has a plan for further destruction.
Right.
And it's hard to forgive someone for something they haven't yet done.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I would say, you know, now is maybe the time to try to reason with her and preemptively achieve a peace. Right? Because, you know, if possible, we want to prevent conflict from happening so that we don't have to be in a position of moral inequality. Right, and you can see now because she's expressing plans of doing something morally injurious that you have the opportunity to intervene.
So one question this sort of a case raises for me is how well do you need to, how much understanding does forgiveness require? At a limit case might be like, whatever you did, I forgive you, right?
Yeah.
Where I don't even need to know what it was that you did in order to forgive you. And then at an extreme case, I need to have like a full understanding of exactly what you did and why it was wrong and your full understanding of its being wrong. Where if we take that extreme example, then extreme vision of forgiveness, then we can say, okay, Mabel is realizing that she didn't have the ground. She thought she had grounds to forgive, but she in fact didn't have grounds to forgive because she mistakenly thought that her sister had a really deep regret, and actually it was just a superficial thing.
So I have mixed feelings on this, because Charles Griswold, one of his conditions for forgiveness is that a person gives an account of how they came to do wrong, why they came to do wrong, and how they have turned around, and now why they're going to do better, and how they're going to do better. So this narrative telling is sort of a precondition for Griswold for forgiveness. I think it probably varies person to person what degree of narrative they need to summon the sort of emotional reserves to forgive.
Mm.
But I would say that I have mixed feelings about this, because sometimes a very thorough accounting of why a person did what they did just makes you madder, right? I don't know if you've ever been in a situation where you're having a conversation with someone and you're like, well, why did you do this?
Yeah.
And they explain it and you're like, no, this isn't getting us anywhere. This is terrible, this is worse. Right, because now I know more things that piss me off about your thoughts, right? About the train of events that led you to do this thing that made me mad. And so in that sense, I can see these sort of narrative accountings which are supposed to raise understanding and bring people closer to a meeting of the minds can actually drive them further apart because they just achieve greater alienation. So I have mixed feelings about that precondition, but I think some narrative is helpful in that they're humanizing, right? And oftentimes the way that people come to wrongdoing is very familiar to us. And when someone explains to you how they came about doing wrong, you start to see like, okay, that's a pretty human story. It doesn't reflect on them as sort of the source of all evil and villainy in the world. And so I have a mixed feelings on those narrative accountings and forgiveness. I think it varies case to case.
Mm. Suppose that we could make one of two changes in the world. We could either make the world just more forgiving, or we could just make everyone less disposed to anger.
Mm-hmm.
Where we're just going to assume that the same amount of moral exceptionalism is going to be reduced by each of these two moves. Do you have a preference between the two?
I think forgiveness is a good spiritual exercise personally. People being less angry about being wronged, it doesn't make them less wronged.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It just makes them feel less bad about it. So it doesn't really solve my inequality problem in the way that forgiveness does, right? It just means that people are less likely to act on it. So it's really a question of, should we make the world more merciful or more forgiving? And forgiveness for me encompasses mercy and that effective transformation involving the discharge of anger.
Makes sense.
And so I would do the plan inclusive.
Okay, I'm gonna ask like two more questions and then we'll do a break. So suppose I do something really wrong and you forgive me. How, like, I get how this could be an a kind of amazing psychological sort of experience for you. But why does, like, your forgiving me have an effect on me? Like, how does it make me equal to myself in my own eyes? How does the relation I have to you change my relation to myself? Is there any kind of guarantee that I will feel that way? Like, that is, isn't it an open question, if you forgive me, whether or not I continue to just feel the guilt that I felt before?
It is, and it has to do with the reception of forgiveness by the individual, and there's no guarantee that they experience it as a restoration. Although I would say that, you know, my experience in my work has been when people reach out to, you know, this gentleman who said that he loves the woman who forgave him more than anyone else in the world. Mm-hmm. He said when he received her letter in which she wrote, you know, here's what you did, it really hurt me. She listed the sort of effect it had had on her. And then she said, but I've thought about it and I forgive you and so on and so forth. He said he fell to his knees and he cried and he sent the letter to his sister-in-law for safekeeping. He made copies of it to keep forever. And, you know, now that he's facing execution, she's someone he wants to be there when he's dying. And I mean, I think that's pretty remarkable. And I think forgiveness has the capacity to bring forth in people feelings of repentance or regret or apology, which can be good feelings to have when you have done something wrong, because they guard against further wrongdoing, for one thing. You don't want to experience that again, generally, when you have immense regret over something you've done. So they can be useful in that way, but they make you a morally, in that sense, better person, right? They fix you morally, those emotions.
Good. So, okay, I have this book in which we write down, like, stuff our kids said. And so this is a thing that my oldest son said when he was 8. He was asked whether he believes in ghosts. He said, "I don't believe in the kinds of shivery, shaky things that come to you in the attic. If that's a ghost, I don't believe in ghosts. But I think a ghost is if you've done something bad in your life. It's the ghost of you did something bad. That fact is like a ghost. It's not physical, and you can't destroy it. It goes on and on forever." So he's saying, like, look, you did a bad thing, and it's always true that you did that bad thing. And that thing is always going to live with you like a ghost. It's going to, like, follow you around, the shadow of your wrongdoing. And, like, I wonder, maybe another person can make me feel like that isn't there. But can another person really take that ghost away? Some part of me wants to say, look, the job of actually, like, killing that ghost would, like, be a job for God. Like, it's such a high task. And that maybe what strikes us as sacred and almost inhuman about forgiveness is that the forgiver is in the place of God, is doing a thing that really only God can do, like killing that ghost. And that would also partly explain why we're very uncomfortable with, you know, forgiveness among friends. It's like the position that you're adopting, it's a very hard position to adopt, but also it's like, can a human being really have that standing?
Yeah, I mean, I think that when someone does something wrong and they morally injure themselves through wrongdoing, this creates standing for revenge with the other person and so forth, and it diminishes them in their relationship to society and so on. And so the other person who has been wronged can discharge, you know, that anger and that capacity, that moral capacity to harm them in a state of moral exception. But the ghost of that thing, and this is why I'm sort of against forgiveness as a therapeutic tool, it can remain. I cannot control how my forgiveness is received, and I cannot force it to be received therapeutically. And so I think it would be completely feasible for someone to say, I've been forgiven by a person for what I've done, but I feel no less guilty, right? I still feel like I'm haunted by this thing that I did. And I mean, I think at that point I would say to that person, well, you've been restored in the eyes of society. But I don't know, I can't tell you about being restored in the eyes of God. That's something that you have to manage in your relationship with the Creator yourself. And, you know, even for secular people who are not religious, once you've been forgiven by someone for something that you did to them, you're forgiven in the eyes of society, and you're good with society and your peers. But you may not be good with yourself, right? And so, you know, a theory of self-forgiveness is something that I am not very clear on, and I want to think about more.
Okay, we should stop there. So, guys, there should be, like, cookies and stuff just outside. And so we'll break for, like, 15, 20 minutes, and then we'll come back. Thank you.
Thank you.
the Q&A portion of this event. And a couple of things. First thing is, just make sure if somebody wants to leave, make it possible for them to leave. So as I say at every Night Owls, this is not a class. And you can leave whenever you feel like it. In fact, you can leave and come back later if you want. We're not offended. Leave whenever you want and make it, you know, especially if you're sitting on the ground or whatever, make it available for people to leave. But we have a nice clean aisle in the middle now, so I think it's going to be okay. Everyone who asks a question gets either a t-shirt or a tote bag, depending on what you want. To get your t-shirt or tote bag, you have to go to the back of the room, okay? And you can do that either right after you ask your question. You can do it when you leave, if you leave before the end of the event, which will be 11:30. We have to stop then, otherwise this building turns us into pumpkins or something. Or you can do it at 11:30 when we stop. Okay, so you can choose which of those times to get your t-shirt, tote bag, etc. I think that's it. So why don't you raise your hands, and we have someone come around with a microphone and then you can ask your question.
Hi, I'm Erica.
Hi, will you actually stand up when you ask your question so we can see you better?
Awesome. Yes, hello.
Hi.
I was wondering if you saw any pitfalls to the act of forgiveness. I feel like this can go in like a couple different directions, but I was thinking about issues around accountability in offering forgiveness too easily or too quickly, and whether that might prevent people from kind of facing the consequences of their actions or taking full responsibility for harms they've committed.
Yeah, so this is something that theorists of forgiveness worry a lot about, and that I think you can deal with in a number of ways. One of the ways you can deal with it is this, and in my talk last night, this is how I dealt with it. When you forgive someone, what you're doing is discharging the state of moral exception that arises, and it has to do with, owes itself to, their diminished moral status. You're able to rampage all over them because they have fewer rights than you. They have lost rights. They have diminished their moral standing through their wrongdoing. When you discharge this state of moral exception, they're returned to equality, but there are other things that can warrant consequences and accountability, right? Other than a lowered state of moral status. So you could even say that accountability and responsibility have to do with someone of full equal moral dignity, and that it's hard to hold someone to account if they are in fact of lower moral status, because in that case, what are you doing? You're going after someone who's already diminished. I think that there are the necessities created by the injury itself that can require repair and reparation, and that is aside and separate from the diminishment of the moral status and is not provided for by the state of moral exception. So I would say that it's still totally possible to hold someone accountable and even to provide for consequences and so forth. It's not like the criminal justice system is incompatible with forgiveness. The examples I've given of forgiveness have taken place even within the criminal justice system, right? It's just that forgiveness has this capacity to restore people to moral equality with one another, and I think that's probably a better basis on which to think about reparation and repair.
Though in the example of like the people in death row, right, that's where it does seem like the forgiveness can potentially become a substitute for, or you know, instead of a certain punishment of putting the person to death, which was seen as like by some people at least as the accountability part of the story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so forgiveness in that case, I mean, I think the death penalty is wrong outright.
Right.
So anytime someone is not killed instead of killed, I think it's a good thing. And right. So I'm...
Right, you know, so in that case...
The wrong person to ask about that.
No, that makes sense. So yeah. The thought is that there, it's really not in place of accountability because that was not an accountability measure at all on your view.
Right, how is someone being held accountable if they're being killed? Right, there's no one there anymore.
Right. I did want to throw in one thought in response to this question, which is that I wonder, I think it makes a lot of sense to say that we can separate forgiveness and accountability, but I also think it's maybe, there's maybe something important about the fact that in general, and you know, your marriage may be somewhat the exception, we can't totally predict that we're going to be forgiven. Like, especially in difficult cases, right? So it's not like, I'm like, well, I'm going to wrong you, but I know you'll forgive me, right? So I can go ahead and do it. There's like a question mark, and this is that, there's something opaque about forgiveness. Like, it's not guaranteed, it's not a given. And that opacity is actually, I think, pretty important to, like, in some sense, the maintenance of correct incentives, where it would be a little bit hard for me to maybe to even get into view the wrongness of my own action if I could immediately see, even before I did it, the forgiveness that was going to come.
Yeah, Isaac of Nineveh is an Eastern saint, has a saying where he says, "The Lord has dropped a veil of difficulty over the face of his kindness to limit our wrongdoing."
Mm.
Right, where if we knew how forgiving God really was, we would just go crazy. Right, and so he has to sort of keep a firm countenance.
Right, yeah. Cool. Okay, next question.
Hi. I was wondering what your thoughts were on the word unforgivable, and going off of the last question, if forgiveness should be offered if the other person does not repent.
So I think it probably varies on a case-to-case basis, and I certainly don't want to be engaged in the business of demanding that people forgive, right? I try to talk about it more in a sense of, you know, becoming forgiving people. Which doesn't command forgiveness in specific situations. It just kind of counsels a practice of forgiveness in daily life. I think, you know, the idea of being unforgivable, I think that word can't apply to things. It can only apply to people. It can't apply to actions. It can only apply to people. Are there any unforgivable people? Maybe. I mean, when I think in the back of my head about, you know, the worst cases that I've interacted with in my career, you know, criminals on death row who've killed children and so forth, I mean, I still think there's some capacity for forgiveness in them because they still have human dignity. They can still be restored to full moral equality with everyone else. So I don't think there are unforgivable people. There are certainly acts that are very, very, very difficult to forgive and that I wouldn't hold anyone, you know, accountable for choosing not to forgive. I understand that entirely. And I don't speak as an expert on forgiveness. I'm not an expert forgiveness giver. I'm just someone who thinks about it.
I think there's a way of thinking about unforgivable where it's like every wrongdoing is unforgivable. There's a philosophy paper. I think it might be one of the shortest philosophy papers on can God make a rock too big for them to lift?
Mm-hmm.
And the paper goes like this, like, yeah, God can make a rock too big for God to lift, and then God can lift the rock. Yeah. It's by Harry Frankfurt. And so, like, there's something, like, I guess I feel like there's something miraculous about forgiveness. Like even the ordinary human cases, there's like something happens that shouldn't be able to happen. And so there's just a way in which everything that was wrong is unforgivable. And then it gets forgiven. And so the thought that from sort of like prospectively it would look unforgivable makes a lot of sense. And that it's related to the opacity about the previous question, right? Like there's a way in which every wrongdoing is unforgivable until it's forgiven. But there's something hubristic about saying, no, I know that I can't get to that other side. I think, like, certainly I don't feel like a human being could ever know that. All they could know is that right now it's unforgivable.
Hello. So I was just wondering, because I feel that the whole conversation has been based on a shared idea of what is wrong. So I was wondering, how would forgiveness look like if the wrongdoer doesn't necessarily agree with the fact that they did wrong? but the other person is still waiting for forgiveness because they do think that that was wrong. So what happens when there's sort of like a disagreement between what is wrong and what is right?
Yeah, I find that very interesting. These disagreements about whether something requires forgiveness seems to be a source of great conflict, actually. And I think it has to do with the fact that needing forgiveness suggests a diminished status, and no one wants to accede to that readily. So people to sort of consent to needing forgiveness, to accede to that, to say, yes, I need forgiveness, is to accede to that diminished status. And I don't know how to resolve those conflicts. I mean, I think about it a lot, precisely because it does make people so angry, and it is so uncanny, almost, when someone confronts you with forgiveness for something that you don't think was wrong. I don't know how to resolve those conflicts, but I do see them as being, you know, morally salient conflicts. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you gave examples of cases where you forgave people and they didn't accept your forgiveness, and you're like, yeah, but I forgive you anyway,
yeah.
Right? So it may be that there can be a bit of a decoupling between the one person's request for forgiveness and the other person's giving of it. And in these cases where there isn't an agreement about wrongdoing, we're going to see that decoupling. There's something you said earlier that I just thought was so interesting that I thought of bringing up in this connection, which is like, you know, maybe it really, really helps for when we don't have the decoupling, when it's coupled, you know, that we do share a point of view on this thing was really wrong and we sort of see it the same way. But that's really hard to do. And so, like, another way in which opacity enters the story is maybe we don't get into too much detail about, like, exactly what I did wrong and exactly how it hurt you. Mm-hmm. And that lack of detail actually allows us to converge and to have the more coupled version of forgiveness. And there's a question, like, one way to really press this question is, like, do we ever really see it the same way? Does the wrongdoer and the one to whom the wrong was done ever really fully, totally, completely see it the same way? Maybe not. And maybe part of what makes forgiveness possible is that we don't always insist on, like, having a completely clear picture.
Yeah, I think that's quite right. And I think that a necessary component of, you know, this is part of my quibbling with Griswold's preconditions, is that one of them has to do with this sort of allocution, where a person is supposed to provide a narrative that tells, you know, how they came to do wrong and so on. But what is the guarantee that you're going to want to hear that and it's not just going to make you madder?
Right.
This is sort of my experience, you know, with that kind of stuff. And so I think, you know, like your son said, you know, I'm sorry I called you a jerk. You want to call it quits. I think that is sort of the ideal outreach, you know, request for forgiveness, in that it doesn't go too deep into the narrative.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay, next question.
Hello. I kind of wanted to ask, how can we forgive someone who has caused us an immense amount of pain and done a lot of harm without really understanding their motivation or reasons, and how do we forgive them, especially when we still care about them?
So I didn't quite understand. Someone who doesn't understand the reasons for which they did the thing they did. Can you just say that part again?
How would you forgive someone who has hurt you, but you really won't know the reason why they have hurt you?
Ah, okay.
So the question is, how do you forgive someone and you don't know the reason?
Yeah, you don't know the reason why they hurt. They hurt you. In some sense, there's no justification that they can offer for why they did what they did or something like that. Or you don't understand why they did what they did. Mm-hmm. I take it. That's the question? Yeah. Okay.
I mean, on one hand, it makes it hard to forgive because it's hard to establish a plan going forward of peace if you don't have an accounting of at least why the person thought this was a good idea. On the other hand, I think it's possible for a person to say something like, look, it's really not worth getting into, but I can assure you it's not gonna happen again because I realize it was wrong. And so that level of opacity, I think, is functional in forgiveness, even if you don't see maybe the level of sort of self-recognition and reflection you would like in the forgiven person. Another thing about forgiveness is it is long acting, right? So forgiving someone gives them the capacity to reflect over a longer period of time, and it's possibly the case that over that period of time, they will come to understand why they did what they did. My experience in talking to people on death row who have committed crime is that oftentimes they don't have a clear understanding of why they did what they did. The motive is often complex and difficult to understand. When you look at your own motives for doing the things you do, they're complex and difficult to understand. And it's just that in this case, we expect a crystal clear sort of hyper thought out motive because the action was so grave. But the action is really no different than any other action in that it's a mix of sort of conscious and unconscious, clear and unclear things.
Yeah, I'm always skeptical when people say, like, well, in order to forgive, the person has to, like, commit to change or something. Because in my life, I feel like it pretty often arises that somebody does something bad and they ask for, like, they're like, I'm sorry. And you know they're going to do it again. Like, it happens to me. There are certain circumstances where I reliably freak out. And I might be like, I'm sorry. I might tell my husband, I'm sorry. And he knows I'm going to do it again, definitely, right? That's who I am. I keep screwing up in this way. But I still can apologize, and he still can forgive me. And I don't think, I could say I commit to changing, but we both know it's not going to happen. And yet it still seems possible. And it seems a little bit like that case where, like, not knowing why they did it is part and parcel of, like, not being able to predict whether they're going to do it again. And sometimes I don't think that's a requirement on forgiveness. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to add one more thing here, which is like that I actually had sort of meant to bring up, which is the thought of like having a really, really clear idea why someone did a bad thing. There may be some kind of puzzle there too, where like evil is just like maybe it's incomprehensible.
it doesn't make sense. That's the thing. I remember talking to the head of the Office of Public Defenders who were representing Nicholas Cruz, who was the Parkland shooter. And he said, you know, I see parents coming into this courtroom day after day, and I want to tell them, if you're looking for answers, you're not going to find them here. He doesn't have them, right? This kid was just seriously messed up. He did not have any answers about why this had to happen, and no accounting he could give of why he did what he did was going to make people go, oh, yes, got it. I see, right? There's simply no accounting of an evil act that is going to make you go, oh, yes, now I see why you did it. So if you're looking at an evil act and you're waiting for that aha moment, you're not going to find it. You need to be looking somewhere else for that catharsis because you're not going to find it in the act itself.
Hi, I'm wondering about the possibility of forgiving oneself. So both the logical possibility, is it possible to forgive oneself in the same way that you can forgive someone else? But then also the ethical possibility of this. I feel like therapists and like sort of adjacent discourses like talk about it being important to forgive oneself for wrongdoing. Is this something that is good, that we should be striving towards?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. I don't have a good answer on self-forgiveness. This is something that I've only just started thinking about. Because there are several things that you can do that relieve you, that provide relief for regret or pain that is caused by prior actions or, embarrassment or humiliation, et cetera. There are things that you can do that relieve that pain that are not necessarily forgiveness proper, right, that don't have to do with the discharging of anger so much as a kind of explaining away or providing an excuse. So when you look back on things you did, you can say, for instance, well, I was very young, among people my age, that really wasn't that uncommon, but that's not forgiveness per se. That's more of providing an excuse, excusing or, diminished culpability in some sense. And so there are a lot of things I think that kind of masquerade as forgiving oneself that really have to do with coming to a greater understanding of one's actions. And so disentangling that kind of internal activity from forgiveness proper is what I'm thinking about as I think about self-forgiveness. But I haven't thought too terribly much about forgiving oneself. It's not in my nature.
Yeah, I feel like I'm really torn about this. So I'll tell you, on the one side, I'm like, it doesn't make any sense. It's like making a promise to yourself. People are always like, oh, promise yourself. It's like, well, I can just release myself at any time from the promise. So the promise doesn't mean anything. So it's like a language that people use, but I feel like it doesn't like get a grip in my psychology. That's on the one hand. So that's like me saying, no, there's no forgiving yourself. On the other side, I feel like there's a you know, moral exceptionalism that you point out. I think one really big arena of moral exceptionalism people have is that they feel that it's okay to do any kind of bad stuff to themselves. Mm-hmm. They make an exception for harm to themselves. Mm-hmm. Like, well, I can't harm other people, but I can harm myself in a variety of ways. Just in terms of indulging in thoughts of self-doubt, of like how you have no self-worth, of just also talking about yourself in that way, talking about yourself in disrespectful ways, in ways you would never think it's okay to talk about another person. And maybe somehow the language of self-forgiveness could get like a grip in this kind of idea that you have moral obligations to respect yourself in the way that you have to other people. And so maybe it's not exactly self-forgiveness, but it's just like, you know, something like learning to move away from that moral exceptionalism in relation to yourself.
Yes, I think that's kind of what I have landed on, because there is a sense in which you are a moral exception unto yourself, in that you can do things to yourself you can't do to other people, and that's just generally true, right? I can feed myself, but I can't go around feeding you, right? And that's true of good things and bad things. But I think with forgiveness, we have to be careful, because forgiveness presumes that there was a bad act to begin with. And in lots of cases where people are sort of terrorizing themselves with negative feelings, self-doubt, self-hatred, self-harm, there was no bad act, right? They're holding themselves sort of hostage to a sort of negative self-regard that they would not find tolerable with respect to anyone else. But there's not necessarily an antecedent act that had to do with any kind of harm or injury. And even if there had been, it would have been harm or injury to themselves, and now they're answering it with more harm and injury to themselves, right? So this is why I think self-forgiveness is a kind of tangled up thing to think about. And I think the way I shake out on it is there should be practices of better moral treatment of the self. And maybe the moral exception is a way to think about it. Why not treat yourself like you would treat another person, right? If you were just a steward of yourself.
Yeah. Cool.
Hello. So sometimes when I've been forgiven too quickly, I feel upset almost, or unfulfilled, uh-huh. Like I've been cheated out of some like longer process, like some struggle to earn that fulfillment. And I've been wondering why, because my initial assumption would be like, when I've done something wrong, I want to be forgiven as soon as possible and return to that peaceful state you were talking about. Mm-hmm. So then why is it that I feel like I deserve some sort of punishment, and I feel angry or unfulfilled or unsatisfied when I'm not given that? And am I like strange for thinking that, or do you think there's like a legitimate theory behind it?
No, I know lots of, I know actually lots of Catholics who are like, they don't give good penances anymore. You know, they're weak. They're weak stuff. So I see that. I think there are a couple of reasons. One is, you know, the fact that if you're forgiven too quickly, if you put yourself in that person's position, you're like, no, have more self-respect. Have more, you know, because that entitles me to more self-respect socially, you know. Prosecute this more, because this entitles me to prosecute this more. And I think that there are a lot of, and not in a cynical or negative way, there are a lot of philosophers who write about forgiveness this way. Jeffrey, what is his last name? I can't remember. He wrote that book with Jean Hampton. Jeffrey Murphy writes about forgiveness in this way, where if it's too ready or too quick, it signals a lack of self-respect. on behalf of the forgiver, and that can make you uncomfortable, especially if you care about the person, right? And so I think another aspect of it is, you know, people can feel like they are due some reparation or some repair. And I would urge you in those situations to do your best to make some repair, because, you know, that's one of the good feelings that forgiveness can provoke. But I think forgiveness itself provokes those feelings because it is a gift. It provokes those feelings of owing or being in debt, as Agnes was saying earlier, you know, of gratitude towards the other person. And I don't think that necessarily means that you're of unequal status. I think it just speaks to forgiveness status as a gift. Yeah.
I also wonder whether this speaks to the wanting the experience of restoration to oneself and feeling like you didn't get that experience and feeling like, well, maybe, like, it's like you might have forgiven me, right? And so I'm restored socially, but inside of myself, I don't feel I have been restored to that status of moral equality. And I wonder, like, is that, will you want to classify that as the therapeutic demand, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, well, I don't feel better, so I think you needed to, like, do more forgiving or wait more before you forgave me or make me suffer more, because the role of your forgiveness is to make me feel better.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that, you know, from my point of view, I would say that's not the role of forgiveness, right? That may be the role of the person you're in a relationship with. Like, that person may owe you, just by the fact of being in a relationship with you, some sort of support, right? But it's not necessarily the role of forgiveness to resolve those leftover feelings of anxiety and, you know, guilt and hauntedness, as we were talking about earlier. Cool.
Hi. So I'm wondering, is forgiveness necessarily something that's one-to-one? Or are there cases where there's sort of social forgiveness? I'm thinking about cases where the wrongdoer has wronged multiple people. Maybe some of them agree that they can be forgiven and some don't. I would love to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, that's a very good question. So Charles Griswold, who wrote one of the sort of major books on forgiveness, says that, you know, it really does have to be sort of interpersonal and social, and he's especially skeptical of the idea of kind of political forgiveness, where forgiveness is happening through various types of representation. On the other hand, I think he's a little warmer to the idea of political reconciliation, which is a sort of, you know, regardless of how people feel effectively, it has to do with making a plan for the future that, you know, involves reconciling for whatever political purposes. It is often the case, at least in death penalty situations, that one member of the family or two or three members of a family might forgive someone, but not the whole family, right? And so I would still classify that person as, you know, forgiven of that crime, but nevertheless, they are still held, you know, in a kind of twilight space by the unforgiveness of the remaining family members, which I think is a really interesting effect.
Good. I'm so glad to raise this question, because this is one thing I didn't get to ask you, is, like, so, you know, say Griswold doesn't think we can have this political forgiveness, but if we suppose for a moment that we can, that it is possible at least some of the time, it certainly would be true that it seems more difficult.
Like, yeah,
it
absolutely
somehow seems. So why is it difficult? Like, somebody does a public apology, you know, and then, like, it sort of doesn't take, or maybe the thought is, well, some people forgive and some don't, just like with the family.
Some people have an easier time forgiving and some people don't. I think when you're dealing with huge groups of people, like on the political level, you know, we talked about last night, people construing harm, you run into issues of standing, where people, their relationship to the wrongdoing is completely different. So think about Eliot Spitzer, No, who did he really owe an apology to? His wife? All of us? I mean, there's a reasonable case you could make for, well, he was doing this while he was an elected representative, and he owes a certain duty of care to the people to act as a kind of moral model and so on and so forth, and not to use taxpayer money to do X, Y, Z. And I think that you can construe those harms in a kind of fair way, but there are also ways of construing harms from public figures that are, it seems sort of unfair, right? That seem maybe a little bit more distant from that. And so I think that's where forgiveness on the sort of public and group level runs into sort of really strange tangles.
I see. So in a way, the issue is that the harms in the first place for which they're being forgiven are not so clear.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
My question is, what's the relationship between disappointment and forgiveness?
That's a really interesting question. I haven't thought about that before. What do you think?
I guess I hadn't either, and it seems to me like disappointment would be something like coming to see the situation in terms of a new and lowered moral framework, where now, like, I used to think I could hold you to these standards, but I now maybe see that I can't. And so I don't actually need to forgive you because I've, like, lowered the standards to match what I now think I can expect of you. Whereas forgiveness involves continuing to hold them to the expectations that you held them to before they fell afoul of them and saying, no, I'm still holding you to those, even though you, departed from them. I think you can live up to those in the future, or something like that.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Cool. That's why disappointment feels a lot worse.
Yeah.
So thinking about like the interpersonal nature of forgiveness and group forgiveness, we sort of all accept that you have the power to forgive or not to forgive when someone else hurts someone you love. Mm-hmm. But in that context, can forgiveness ever be wrong? So if someone hurts like my loved one and my loved one doesn't forgive that act, but I say like I forgive that act, mm-hmm. a lot of people would consider that to be like an extremely wrong act of forgiveness. So I was just wondering what you thought about that.
No, I think that that can be okay, actually, because I think that it's very culture bound whether or not we think you have standing to forgive someone if they hurt your loved one in the first place. So in our culture, for example, if you somehow wronged a child, which is kind of a funny thing to imagine, but like if you somehow offended a child, it would make sense for you to apologize to them and their parents, just because a child isn't really fully detached from their parents in a way. They're kind of still mixed up and entangled together. Or we also view spouses as being kind of one person in a certain kind of way, where if you did something, you know, really bad, if you badly wronged a husband, you might apologize to a husband and wife, right? Because you did an offense against their kind of domestic situation, their domestic peace. And so in that sense, because those harms are transferable in a certain way in certain situations, and it appears to me culture bound what situations count, I think you possibly can forgive, right? So if someone really wrongs my husband and it screws up our household for a while, right? But he's going through this thing and whatever, I think I would be in a certain position to say, look, I forgive them. I'm over it at some point. And I think it would be viewed as kind of a strange act potentially, because on the one hand, we live in a society that is highly individualistic and highly atomized and sort of wants to say standing is this extremely individual thing that only applies between one individual and another. But on the other hand, we have these countercurrents in society that say, no, children and parents, husbands and wives, these kinds of, you know, spouses, they actually do have relationships that kind of muddle up that kind of atomization. And so because of that, I think it's not as wrong as it might initially seem. I think there might actually be more logical sense to it, especially culture to culture.
So I think the cases you say make sense, but I took it that the case that was being asked about was one where the person themselves does not forgive, mm-hmm. right? And I think there is something offensive in that case, and...
Like a betrayal of the...
Yeah, so I think, like, suppose someone wronged me, and I was, like, really, really angry at the person, but my husband is like, well, I forgive you. I think it's okay that you did that to her. And so I think that what happens when, like, say, if my husband, like, forgives someone is he becomes, in a way, my representative, which makes a lot of sense, like, in the case of the granddaughter, right? So the granddaughter who forgives is the representative of the dead person, and the dead person's not there to do it, and it sort of makes sense that the granddaughter would serve as the representative. But if I'm still alive and I'm still here and someone is serving as my representative, that makes it seem like I'm not in my right mind. I don't have the capacity to, like, make this decision for myself, right? And I think that's the element of it that is offensive. It's the having a representative that when you, you know, where that, like, they're clearly diverging from what you yourself say. You're still around to say the thing that you say. And, like, that we could actually imagine that happening in a case where the person was severely mentally ill, right? If I'm severely mentally ill, my husband might say, look, I forgive you. She's not forgiving you right now because she's, you know, not in a state to do that, right? And then, and I think what's offensive about the case where I'm not severely mentally ill, but I'm in a way I'm still being treated as though I can't make that judgment for myself. That's how I would see it.
Yeah, and I can also see someone feeling as though it's a betrayal just because, you know, you're saying, I mean, the way you glossed it was, actually, I forgive you. Your husband saying, I forgive you. I think it's okay that you did that to her.
Someone might
quibble with that and say, well, forgiveness doesn't mean you think it's okay.
Right.
However, if I were in the position where I were still angry and not forgiving the person, I would see that forgiveness as being a signal that my husband potentially felt that way. And so it might be experienced as a betrayal, but just logically putting it together, because the harm is sort of transferable in a certain way, I think you might have standing. And so it might be something that logically you're entitled to, however it might be, you know, kind of offensive, a little off color to do, yeah.
Right, yeah, cool, it's a good question.
Hi, my name's Olivia, thank you so much for being here. In thinking about categories or topics that you would deem unforgivable, I'm really curious for your thoughts on the relationship between cancel culture and forgiveness. Do you find cancel culture to be helpful or productive? And how do you think it has impacted the nature of forgiveness right now?
I think Agnes is right in that forgiveness is sort of this perennially off-key topic. Right, because it's hard to say you need to summon the will to forgive, et cetera, because it's seen as something kind of sacred, something that has to come from within. So I don't know that cancel culture has made us a whole lot more punitive than we once were. I think social media makes the level of punitiveness that we already had much more immediate, right? People can get to you with their sort of punitive thoughts in a way that maybe they couldn't in the 90s. But there's a book coming out that I just saw, The Case for Cancel Culture, How This Democratic Tool Liberates Us All.
All right. Someone had to write it.
Somebody had to write it. I have not read it yet, but I want to because, you know, I think like most people, my sense of cancel culture is like, well, you know, it kind of sucks. But I have not read anyone theorize it to a degree where I feel comfortable even assessing it.
Right.
Right? Because I don't feel like I have a good grip on what exactly I'm talking about. Like at this point, I feel like it's just the mood of social media that is cancel culture. And like I generally find the mood of social media to be a little bit problematic, but that doesn't mean that it's logically wrong. I just haven't read it theorized well enough to actually get into it.
I really do think there is something here about where about the relation between these two concepts. And it's like, what, you know, one thing you see a lot in social media I've experienced is like, you do something that's seen as wrong and it kind of keeps coming back at you. Like every time you do the new wrong thing, all the old wrong things come back. So there's this like lack of forgetting, right? It would be like if like, you know, in a marriage, like your spouse like brought up all the bad things you did in the past every time you did a new bad thing. I think that, and I think even the very idea of sort of cancellation, and there's also a lot of language of things being unforgivable and also resistance to forgiveness. I think it's like, the way I think about it is, in everyday life, we all realize that sometimes we're gonna screw up and we're gonna need people to forgive us. That's just like, it's like obvious to everyone. And maybe they don't have to say the words, I forgive you. Maybe you don't have to say the words, I apologize. But these are like, we just have these practices of repair that are just like built into our human interactions. But we're not so sure they apply on social media or in the public. What is that to say? It's to say, maybe in the public sphere, we think it's maybe okay to just cut someone out. You know, we just kill them. Like, not actually murder them, right? But somehow excise them from the public sphere. That seems to people to be like a thing it might be okay to do. Because somehow they're not connecting the like the sort of social needs and like human interconnectedness of us, like which they all recognize in the everyday. They're not seeing that as being true of like being on Twitter. Like, you know, well, just get off. Like, just go away. Where there's a thought like, oh, that's fine. You can still go on to live your life, right? And so I think that it is somehow there's something like a denigration of the public sphere that's implied by the thought of never forgive, never apologize, et cetera, is to say we can forswear these practices of repair that we so obviously need in our everyday lives. We don't need them here because it's okay to be cut off from that space.
Yeah. One thing I would say about cancel culture is that you know, just from the subtitle, How This Democratic Tool Liberates Us All, I would just be careful about what you're being liberated from, right? Because it's possible that you're just being liberated from the normal state of morality and you're entering into a state of moral exception. So I always wonder when people are canceling other people, do they feel like, man, I don't like to, but somebody's got to do it. You know, I'm putting in my work in the cancellation mines. Like, no, they're enjoying it. And so, therefore, there's a motive there that's not just about a democratic tool that's liberating us. And this is what I suspect my children of. You know, in our first email exchange about me realizing that when one of my kids gets hit by the other, they like it. Because then they get to go ham. They get to go hog wild. Because they're like, she hit me first. All bets are off. I mean, they get to go nuts. And I realize people like it when they're mad and they are in a state of moral exception.
Right.
And I was like, oh, this is why all the forgiveness stuff in the Bible, yeah. People enjoy this.
Hello, I'm Shiv. I'm a first-time attendee, and I've been really enjoying the talk so far. So my question concerns the role of moral inequality in forgiveness. So do you think moral inequality is inherent in the act of forgiveness? Because when you forgive someone, you're kind of putting yourself in a position where you're an arbiter of somebody else's actions. And is it possible to forgive someone in a way that doesn't make any claim to moral superiority?
Well, I think if you're going to accede to the idea of forgiveness at all, you have to accede to the idea that there are moral rights and moral wrongs, right? And in the sense that you have been morally wronged, yeah, you're going to have to arbitrate that and say, yes, that was wrong. If you're going to adopt a position that you're no arbiter of what's right and wrong, then you can't be wronged, essentially. Yeah, I think we all have to take that position of arbitrating what is right and wrong in our own lives, at least to the degree that we have a say in what is done to us and whether it's right and wrong. Yeah, so I think there's no way around that in forgiveness.
I will say that, like, Nietzsche was so influenced by this thought, the thought that in order to forgive someone, in some sense, you put yourself above them, that he thought the thing to do is just take a small revenge. Someone, you know, someone hurts you, hurt them back a little. Not like a crazy amount, a little amount, and then move on. Don't ask them for forgiveness. You know, don't make them ask you for forgiveness and do an apology and groveling. That's so, it's inhumane, he thought, right? He's like, just slap them, you know, and then be done with it. And I think it's because he was kind of repulsed by this idea of one person being an arbiter over another in that way and like lording that over the other person.
Yeah, I think my skepticism towards that comes from, I don't think people are just gonna do a slap and let it go. And my exhibit A would be social media.
Right, right, so I think that's right. There's a real question about the feasibility of the like Nietzschean approach.
Hi. So I've been thinking about the scenario when maybe you've forgiven someone, but you keep them under a state of surveillance, and that maybe you're sort of like looking at the future and your tolerance for future harm from that person has been permanently diminished by that original bad act. And I guess I'm wondering, did you really forgive them in the first place for that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think you did. And, you know, this is because it's about moral equality in a state of, you know, diminished moral equality, but it doesn't require that you forget that this person has a habit of doing X, Y, or Z, right? It doesn't require a total erasure of that. It just requires that you no longer take it into accounting of their moral status, right? So you cannot do things to them. You cannot react to them in a way that is dictated by their prior bad act. But that doesn't mean that you have to respond to future bad acts as though they are the first bad act, right? I don't think it has to a kind of retroactive negation effect that way.
So I think that the phenomenon that you're pointing to is actually super pervasive, and the way to see that it's kind of there in almost all the cases is just like, if you had to get forgiven for something really big that you did wrong, like, you probably can't joke about that with that person. Like, if someone's gonna, like, suppose you betrayed your friend by, like, telling a secret, right? Like, if someone's gonna make a joke about telling your friend secrets, it's not gonna be you. And that's already an indication there's, like, a bit of a restriction on you, right? I have two ways that I think about this. One way is to say, yeah, that's totally reasonable, you know, they forgave you, but it wasn't forgotten, et cetera. And the other is, look, maybe there's such a thing as perfect forgiveness and we just can't achieve it. Like, maybe there is something like an ideal of forgiveness, and in that ideal, if we achieve that ideal, like divine forgiveness, then they could even make the joke. And that's just like a really tall order.
I don't know if this has been asked before, but are you owed forgiveness if you apologize? And also, how do you cope with not being forgiven?
Sorry, I missed the first part. How do you cope with what?
With not being forgiven.
Ah.
Are you owed forgiveness if you apologize? Well, I think people are generally, I think we all have an interest in establishing a general moral equality between people. And you can look at that as, well, this person is owed forgiveness. I had a friend put it to me this way. We give people forgiveness for the same reason we give hungry people food, because they need it, right? So I wouldn't look at so much as that they are owed it, but that they need it. When someone comes to you and they apologize, it's not that you owe them something and they've created a debt, but rather that they have expressed a need. And I would look at it that way. How do you cope with not being forgiven? That's a very good question. I mean, forgiveness isn't necessarily something that's going to heal your wounds anyway. You know, this is sort of my take on the therapeutic approach to forgiveness and my skepticism of it. But I think that there are a variety of tools that you can use, but I mean, you're always going to have a problem in society, I think, as long as you remain unforgiven. People deal with that in a number of ways. There's in fact a movie called Unforgiven about this state I think it's difficult.
I think I agree basically on both points. I think a way to, I like the way you were putting it in terms of a gift, right? And so if you think about a gift, you're never owed a gift. Like even if it's your birthday, nobody owes you a present. And yet, like, you'd be sad if it was your birthday and you didn't get any presents. So if we think of it as a gift, then I think it makes sense to say you're not owed it, you can need it. I think that, so like I have, like there's one person in my life who has not forgiven me for something that I did to her that was bad. And I don't think she'll ever forgive me. And I, like, so like we can ask me, how do I cope with that? And like, it kind of, it's like Abe's ghost, my son's like ghost. It kind of haunts me. Like it is kind of like a ghost that's there. Sometimes I write about it. A lot of times I don't think about it. It's something where like I have dreams about her. So it's like showing up in my unconscious. And I think you don't like really fully get over it. It's like being haunted by a ghost, but like any bad stuff in your life, even if you don't get over it, you still sort of do something with it. Like you process it in your life and it just shows up in a bunch of different ways.
Oh, hi, everyone. Well, in cases where the pain is so big, like, let's say, cheating, and the person constantly remembers and suffers about it, would you say that forgiving is kind of unhealthy for the forgiver in the long term?
Well, I guess I don't look at it in terms of health. I look at it in terms of morality and equality. There are cases where forgiving is certainly uncomfortable, and there are cases where even if a person is going to forgive, they don't need to be in that relationship anymore, right? People can forgive, and that doesn't mean a total restoration of the relationship. It can make sense to forgive and part ways, would be my take, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's right. Like in some sense, the relationship might be unhealthy, and
yeah.
That might be an important determination to make, but it does seem separable from the question of whether you can forgive the person. And so maybe what the person is really asking for is a kind of reconciliation to the terms of the relationship, and if the thought is that might not always be the right move, that might not always be to the benefit of both parties, like that seems to make sense to me.
Yeah.
Returning to the previous question about somebody offering forgiveness on somebody else's behalf, I'm curious about institutional forgiveness. Mm. For instance, say in a university, if somebody wrongs another person and that wrong also is wrong in whatever the code of ethics of the institution is, and the individual doesn't forgive the wrongdoer, but the university or institution does, or vice versa, where the individual does, but the institution doesn't. Curious about those implications.
Yeah, many such cases. Institutions forgiving is sort of a weird thing to think about again because, you know, you would have to have a case where the institution was harmed for them to have sort of standing. Institutions can choose not to penalize, right, which is a kind of mercy, I suppose. It's obviously discomforting when you are someone who is not forgiven a perpetrator, but institutions have, and vice versa, I imagine. But you see it a lot in the criminal justice system. For example, the families feel differently than the criminal justice system does about the forgiveness of a perpetrator. And it creates a lot of angst, frankly, when there's a mismatch in the sort of institutional response to a perpetrator versus those who feel like they were actually directly affected. And DAs, et cetera, will try to talk to families in order to unite those separate sentiments about what should become of someone. But ultimately, they're not always united, and it does create, I think, a kind of feeling of disjointedness and is a source of great unhappiness, yeah.
Yeah, like a place where I've seen this shown up, and maybe I'm sort of, I have a feeling, actually, I'm not quite thinking about the sort of cases that you're thinking about, so we may not quite be on the same wavelength, but is just cases where, let's say there's like some historical figure and like a building is named after them, but then like it emerges that they did some bad thing, right? And actually what has struck me about those cases is that it doesn't really seem like there's like a way for forgiveness to be on the table there. Like what tends to happen is erasure. Like, well, maybe we'll remove their name from the building. We'll remove the statue of them. And then there's a lot of like disputes over what should happen there. And it, like, I mean, it hadn't sort of occurred to me until now that in a way, the problem is that like the set of options that you have are sort of impoverished, because how could you possibly forgive, you know, someone from hundreds of years ago for like a thing that the people who were wrong, that was like long, long time ago, right? So we sort of are, I mean, and maybe in the cases I'm thinking of, part of the problem is like the question of who is being harmed, right? And forgiving harms, you gotta get the harmed people there, and maybe they can do the forgiving, or we have to have a harm on the table, rather than just some kind of a very abstract representation of a possible harm, or a past harm, or something like that. But anyway, it does strike me that it's just a feature of those cases that it seems like our set of options is impoverished precisely because forgiveness just isn't one of them.
So to your point about harm, it seems to me that like intuitively it is clear to us that like saying I'm sorry I hurt you is different than saying I'm sorry for what I did. Mm-hmm. Does there exist like a symmetry between that and the forgiveness of harm caused versus the forgiveness of what you did? And if that's the case, then like how do we take into account like the idea of like Catholic confession, for instance, in which you were like, you know, confessing to what you did, but maybe not like rebalancing the harm you caused to somebody else? Yeah.
This is where I think the opacity is helpful, in that sometimes if someone too much disentangles what they're exactly sorry for, it can only be further angering, right? Because they might be sorry for not exactly what they did, but how it made you feel, right? And no one likes to hear, I'm sorry you feel that way, right? That's the sort of ultimate non-apology apology. You want them to be sorry they did it. In that case, if that's all somebody can offer, I would suggest a somewhat more opaque apology. But I think the ideal form of apology is one in which someone is sorry for both what they did and the effects it caused, right? I'm sorry that I hurt you and that it made you feel bad, right? That would be the ideal form of an apology. And if you can't achieve that, then you want the more opaque kind of narration about what happened.
Yeah, I think there's something very deep here about the tension between these two formulations. So when I say, I'm sorry that you feel that way, what I'm doing is I'm sort of saying, look, there's like a set of feelings that you're undergoing, and I can maybe even empathize with your feelings. Like, suppose I hadn't done anything wrong to you, and you're just like feeling really lousy today. I could be like, I'm sorry you feel that way. That wouldn't be offensive, right? It'd be fine to say, I'm sorry that you feel that way. It's a problem to say that when I'm the one who made you feel that way, right? Because I'm leaving something out, which is that I did it. And I can say, well, I'm sorry I did it. I'm sorry I did this, like, you know, committed this injustice against you. But then I'm not bringing in, I'm like focusing on me, right? There's something sort of wrong with that too, which is like, I feel so guilty. I feel so bad about the thing I did. Me, right? And that, it seems like I'm centered on myself and my own wrongdoing and not on its effect on you. And I think it's true that in some way the ideal apology combines those two things but makes them one thing. Not just like, it's not, the ideal apology is not two bad apologies. I'm sorry that I did it, me, and I'm sorry that you feel that way, right? It somehow fuses them into one thing. It's not actually totally clear that's possible. Like, those two thoughts have a kind of tension in them, I think. So I think this is just like a deep paradox about apology. And in some way, when people try to apologize to us, sometimes we trip them up on it. We're like, you broke those rules, you know? You can always trip them up. because they're always going to break some rule, because there's a, like a deep paradox here, I think. And so, you know, you can learn the locutions a little bit. You could be like, okay, I better not say I'm sorry that you feel that way, because people are going to get pissed off if I say that. I got to put it some other way, right? Maybe I got to pair the two expressions together. But that's almost like a verbal point. And like, I think there is this just, to me, there just remains this question of, do we ever actually articulate the thought that's the correct apology thought, right? Is there a successful way to do that and really get it exactly right? Or are we kind of hiding behind opacity the whole time? Mm-hmm. And maybe we are. Yeah.
And maybe that's okay.
Okay. So you spoke about the obligation to give people forgiveness because they need it, right? So what do you think about the ethics of withholding forgiveness from someone for their own good? Let's say, for example, you have like a family member or a friend who keeps repeating the same mistake over and over again, and they get some sort of relief from your forgiveness, and they keep repeating the mistake, even if they say they are going to stop. And you're prepared to forgive them another time, but you realize it's not good for them because they keep repeating the mistake over and over again. Do we still have the obligation to give people forgiveness because we're prepared to when they need it?
So I would just return to my theory, my hope, my idea that that accountability and consequences are separable from forgiveness, right? And so that it is possible to forgive but to still hold someone accountable and so on and so forth. So in that sense, forgiveness can't be bad for someone in that you're raising them, you know, you're discharging the state of moral exception, and you're moving them back to moral equality. And in my opinion, they're even more fit to be held accountable in that state precisely because you're respecting them more as a moral equal. That would be my take.
So I think it's a super interesting case where, in effect, you're discovering, and I think it could, as a matter of empirical fact, be something you discover, that forgiveness is anti-therapeutic for a person,
yes.
Right? And so, like, I agree, you can separate out, you know, the accountability and the whatever. Like, you can be like, I'm still going to try to help them. But it could be the case that you learn, like, yeah, but if you try to help them and you forgive them, the forgiveness part is going to be anti-therapeutic, and it's going to interfere, right? And I think why this case is so interesting is it gets to the question of sort of almost who is the forgiveness for, right? So if it's like for me in the sense that, like say I'm forgiving you, right, that I have to get clear in my own head about how I think about this, getting sort of straight in my own mind, and like it's not about creating any kind of effect on you or having any, you know, then I might forgive you irrespectively of how you're going to respond. But if it's about... if I'm at least cognizant of and concerned with, like, the effect on you, then maybe the anti-therapeutic effect is going to worry me, and I'm going to say, as much as I would like to forgive him, and even if that would do good things for me, this is not the time. So it strikes me that that's at least, it's at least a conceivable case. And, you know, I think there is a thing we do. Like, I feel like I do it with my kids where you let something sink in for a minute, you know? Like, and it might not even be wrongdoing. It might be like, I bake with my middle son and he will just screw something up. And, like, I will tell him it's okay, right? I will tell him it's okay. But I'll wait, like, 5 seconds. Just so it's like... okay, but like, don't just smash the egg into the bowl next time or something. Like, I feel like he's gonna learn more from this experience if I give him a few seconds to be like, So I think we are quite aware of those anti-therapeutic effects, and maybe it's part and parcel of being in this superior position of the forgiver that you kind of take on the burden of care for the person that you're forgiving such that forgiveness might not be the most caring thing to do. Like, I guess I'm okay with that as a possible case.
I was wondering about the difference between agent-centric and action-centric forgiveness. Is forgiving someone purely because of your relationship with them a less inherently moral practice than forgiving the action itself?
No, I don't think so. Not necessarily. I don't think it has to be I mean, so the question is it less moral to forgive someone you have a relationship with and to forgive the action itself?
I thought the question was just, when you forgive, is the object of your forgiveness the agent or the action?
Yeah.
Because you might have thought, what you did was unforgivable. I can never forgive that, but I forgive you or something.
Yeah, I think it's the agent. Yeah, I think people have to be the object of the forgiveness, not the action itself, because they don't have moral status as actions. You know.
Yeah, I guess I feel less sure about that. Like, you know, one thing that speaks in favor of that is that forgiveness often involves in some way detaching the action from the agent and being like, sort of explaining how this doesn't reflect who I really am in some sense, right? That could well figure as part of my apology. But I also think that there's some amount of like coming to terms with that you did this thing.
Yeah.
Like not just that you are you, but that you did this thing where the action seems really relevant to the forgiveness. It's mentioned in the forgiveness. It's mentioned it's front and center. We're attending to it. We're thinking about it. It's the reason why we're occasioning forgiveness. Maybe in Greek, some verbs take a double accusative. Like you can like teach someone something, right? And it's not like you teach it to them. You just teach. You teach the person and you teach the thing. And it may be that forgiveness is like that. You forgive the deed and the person, and it has like two complements or something. I guess that is how I think about it. You wouldn't forgive the deed absolutely. You forgive the deed only in relation to this person, but it's like, I can't just like, if I'm teaching Aristotle, I can't just teach Aristotle like to the heirs. Like, I gotta teach it to some group of students, right? And so the action is forgiven only in the context of an act of forgiveness that also has as its object an agent.
So philosophers of history, you know, they often debate like what matters in history, which is, you know, is the reality of the transpired events, or is it the perception that we have of them? So mapping this debate to like a personal history, do you see the perception of a relationship, like a historical relationship between two people, as like mattering more, or rather the actual like facts of that relationship? When we forgive, do we like forgive in a way that's like real, that enacts like real, or do we just merely change the perception and the interpretation of what's happened before between people?
So I think I don't fully understand the question. So the idea is that when you forgive, do you change the facts or do you merely change your perception of the facts?
Yes.
Okay. I mean, I guess I think that the only reason why we're in the forgiveness game in the first place is that we think that there are at least, like, even if we say we're changing the perception of the facts, we think there are certain facts that are constituted by the perception of those facts, and we like care about those facts, right? So so I guess I'm not sure. I certainly think we can draw a distinction between, say, forgiving and merely appearing to forgive, right? Mm-hmm. Which is the sort of distinction you might have worried you couldn't draw if you thought it's only about perception. But I think you can cash out that distinction as being in terms of like caring in some way about a perception, because whether someone loves you is a perception of a certain kind, right? So I guess I'm not sure, because some of the realities in play are attitudes, I'm not sure I feel like the distinction is so much gets a grip.
Yeah, that would be my sense. I mean, theorists of forgiveness who talk about it, like Griswold, tend to say that it's transformative. I think it was Jean Hampton who says that in forgiveness, you go from seeing someone as morally bad to seeing them as potentially morally decent. But I find those to be the facts that, as Agnes says, are constitutive of the case itself. So it's sort of a both and.
We have time for one more question.
forgive me if I didn't get to you. I'm sort of curious what you think of the idea of like making it up to someone, especially when the person who is giving the apology and has done something wrong is saying, let me make it up to you, maybe in this way, and whether that, how that compares to when someone who's receiving the apology and potentially giving forgiveness says, yes, but you must make it up to me in this way.
Yeah.
What was the question?
So what the idea of making it up to someone, like if I do something wrong to you and then I'm like, let me make it up to you, what is that? What is the making it up to? Because like maybe you should just forgive me, right?
Yeah.
And then what's the difference between me saying, let me make it up to you, and you saying, yeah, I'll forgive you, but you have to make it up to me?
Yeah, I don't mind making it up to you. I think that reparation and repair, which is you know how the forgiveness theorists talk about this, can be, and in a lot of cultures are, just a part of, part and parcel of the process of forgiveness. And I think it'll just depend case to case, whether you want to see some sort of down payment, essentially, on that plan of peace. And so someone making it up to you is a signal that they are quite sincere in their intention to, you know, behave peaceably with you going forward. And so I think it's culture-bound, the tendency to do that, and I think that, you know, where it's a precondition for forgiveness, it doesn't pose a problem for forgiveness per se. I think it can be excessively punitive if you're like, you have to make it up to me and XYZ, and it's actually constitutive of some kind of revenge. But supposing it's not that, I think it can be a perfectly fine part of the process.
So I agree, but maybe I'll just add something about why it sort of sounds so different when the one person says, let me make it up to you, versus the other saying, you need to make it up to me. They both might be fine, speech acts, but we hear a huge difference, like a huge gulf, right, in sort of like the conditions of forgiveness, and somehow the first one sounds a lot better than the second. I think it's that the making it up to you functions at least in part as a signal, right? So when I say I want to make it up to you, I'm signaling that I really take this wrong seriously, I'm signaling a lot of the material that makes it then possible for you to forgive me. And I think it's very different if you say to me, I need a signal from you. That is, that's a thing about the logic of signals, that it's a much better signal if it's issuing from me unilaterally than if you say to me, I need a signal, give me a signal. Because if I give you a signal that you asked for, I'm kind of just giving the signal because you asked for it, right? It seems more of a signal of the fact that you asked me for a signal than it does a signal of my like deep intentions. And so that's why a lot of the times, like when, like, you know, if like your spouse doesn't get you a gift for your birthday or might forget, and you might be like, well, maybe I should remind them that it's my birthday so that they don't screw up and not get me a present. But then the present won't be as good of a signal that they, right? So I think that that's what's accounting for the difference there. All right, thank you guys all so much, and special thanks to Audrey and Avery and Jermaine for all their help. And please come back in a few weeks.